Very good morning to all of you. I'm very happy to be with you this morning to share some of the very latest concepts and ideas relating to teaching methods. You are in the 21st century world, which is very rapidly changing. It's very sad commentary on our classrooms that our classrooms are not changing so fast. Everything other than our classroom is changing, but not our classrooms. And the 10 behaviors I narrated to you as findings of research on effective teaching, effectiveness of teaching, 5 are the key behaviors. That is lesson clarity, instructional variety, teacher task orientation, learning engagement, and student success rate. Success rate is defined here as the correct understanding of what is being done and what is being desired as a part of engagements, as a part of the task orientations which have been thought to conform to the objectives with which we are teaching. The 5 helping behaviors, if you recall, 5 helping behaviors: structuring, questioning, probing, using student ideas. I started with using student ideas, then structuring, questioning, probing, and teacher affect, AFFECT. These behaviors, they work as catalysts. Catalyst, you know, one which is put in something and then it starts changing. So the entire teaching learning process gets catalyzed because of these 5 behaviors, and technically we call them helping behaviors. So daily in your presentations you should try to make use of student ideas by asking them to comment, using their comments in your presentations. Then you'll find that students' interest in the subject will rise. And you'll find that there'll be variety also, instructional variety. There'll be clarity also. So the 5 key behaviors get catalyzed by the 5 helping behaviors. That is how you have to take it and interpret it while making use of it in your classroom transactions. My today's presentation will focus on 2 types of strategies or methods we have to use and we have been using, but researches have brought to light further insights into learner accomplishments, learners learning as a result of teaching. So I will slowly and gradually build up a scheme for you which you can use and which you can operate on when you are in your classrooms. I am not going to sermonize. Sermons are very easy to give, but very difficult to practice. And particularly on this land, when Lord Buddha gave his sermons, we have found very difficult to practice. So I would like to remain at the practical grassroots level. How you can make use of them. Before I do that, as I told you, broadly we classify our teaching methods or teaching strategies under two heads: direct and indirect or indirect strategies. For instance, when I am lecturing to you, I am developing certain ideas which I did yesterday with the help of a structure. That is direct teaching. I gave you 6 keys and each key was elaborated with sub-keys systematically. This lecture format is a direct teaching method. And we have been using it for long, for large classes, for bigger classes. But when you have smaller classes, these methods do not prove to be so effective as other methods. When you have smaller classes, then probably it will be a dialogue which will be more effective. Question, answer, question, answer. Student asking question. Are you stimulating students to ask questions? And then you answer, or the answer may be given by the students. So this session is called dialogic session. Dialogic. Dialogue based on dialogue. Great teachers have been using this. Buddha used this method, dialogic method. When he got enlightenment, he said, I will not accept this bodhisattva because I have become Buddha, okay, but I want to share this enlightenment with the lay public, with the general masses. And as you know, Buddha went from village to village, from Sarnath, this place, and he used to discuss, present his findings as a researcher to the masses at their level and in their language. That is a wonderful teacher like. That is what made Buddha an inimitable teacher. And he used to understand the pulse of the audience. How will they understand more? How will I be able to click with them more swiftly without any use of formal word? So he used to do this. That is dialogic method. Lord Krishna, in the battle of Mahabharata, on the land of Kurukshetra, you know, he entered into a dialogue with Arjuna. For that matter, all your pupils, all your students are Arjunas, and you are playing the role of Lord Krishna. If you deserve that title, and you don't earn it, you have to deserve it. The battle was in the process, and then Arjuna says, let me watch who are the people who are going to fight. And then he said, after looking at the people, they are all my kins and relations. I'm not going to fight. And Lord Krishna says, it's a very difficult thing. The student says, I don't want to learn. I refuse to learn. So he gave the entire Bhagavad Gita. It is an example of a dialogic presentation. That is how great teachers teach. I don't want to suggest and create any inferiority feelings in you by saying that you cannot be Lord Krishna. You can, provided you have attempted that realization and that perfection which belongs to any good teacher. So, let me come down to the point. When you are face to face with your students, one method available to you directly is to talk to them on the subject with keys already made, as I did yesterday. That is an exemplification, that is an example of a direct method of teaching that saves our time. Lots of contents, ideas, thoughts can be presented quickly, logically, through such expositions. We call it lecture method. And therefore, you should not take it as something unimportant if we use the word direct method. Both methods are important in their own ways. These two methods, they develop two types of learning. So you should be very clear about the types of learning. Lower types and the higher types. And remember the three keywords for describing lower types of learning. How many of you are familiar with Bloom's taxonomy? Have you heard of the name of Bloom, Professor B.S. Bloom? Long back in America, he did a wonderful job. And he developed a taxonomy of educational objectives. The three domains of taxonomy are cognitive, affective, and psychomotor. So please note down the taxonomy, and then I will relate to the taxonomy, the lower and higher level learning. In cognitive domain, you write down, in cognitive domain, the lowest level is the knowledge level. Knowledge level. Then next higher, you know, taxonomy is a classification. It's hierarchical. So the higher level will include the lower level. So the lowest level is knowledge level. Knowledge level means helping the students to remember, recognize, recall ideas, to register ideas, to remember ideas. That is called memory level. Knowledge level, that is recall and recognition of facts. Facts, the important thing, facts, events, anything that you memorize and that you register in your memory is the lowest level. In Bloom's taxonomy, it is called knowledge level. Then second higher level is understanding level. When you start relating one fact with another fact, one idea with another idea. And you start putting that idea in your own words. That is called translation. You are able to translate the ideas in your own words, then it becomes comprehension. So it's high level mental function involved. So knowledge level, then second higher level, comprehension or understanding level. Comprehension will include knowledge level. Then the next third level is application. Application. Putting the knowledge and comprehension to use in new situations. Suppose you have taught the students that 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. Now you have to test whether he can take up this operation in actual situations or not. So you give them two pebbles, these are two pebbles, these are two pebbles, how many pebbles it makes. That is application. These are two pencils, these are two pencils, how many pencils there are. That becomes application. They can count up to two. Okay. They see the relationship that two and two is, now they are applying this two plus two, or two into two, multiplication or division, or you take the language. You have noun words. You have words which are names, and you call them nouns. Now they know what is a noun. They can give a definition, and they understand. Now you give a situation and ask them to sort out the noun words. That is application. Ask them to identify the noun words. This exercise will go with the application. Most of the things that you teach in your classrooms, they require application. And if you do not promote application, you cannot become effective. In order to become effective, you should start from knowledge, develop this knowledge to the level of comprehension or understanding, and then further develop it to the level of application. All these three levels are called lower level learning. And I will use three keywords which are used now in researches: learning of facts, learning of rules, and learning of action sequences. These three keywords: facts, rules, and third, action sequences. When you teach in your classroom and your emphasis is on teaching of facts, and the anticipated learning outcome is that they should memorize certain facts or understand the relationship between one fact and the other, you are at the lower level. You are teaching them facts, you are teaching them rules, what makes 2 plus 2 plus 2 so much, 3 plus 3 plus 3 plus 3 so much, the rules they learn. So learning of facts, learning of rules, and learning of action sequences. Here are two things, put them in an order. Action sequences, application. Then the three higher level learning. In Bloom's taxonomy, I have put them under knowledge, comprehension, and application. You will have three higher levels. The three higher levels are analysis, after application, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. Analysis, So I put them now most of us in our classroom stop at knowledge level. In our examinations also, we only test memory. It's very unfortunate. Teaching and learning should not be given this treatment. You must raise the level of your students. The purpose of teaching is to help students become thoughtful persons. And they cannot be thoughtful unless you develop their cognitive faculty. So cognitive faculty, the highest level of the cognitive faculty is evaluation, critical thinking. Evaluation means critical thinking. Given this and this and this, and given this criterion, decide what is to be done. As the judge does in the court, takes evidences, uses criteria, and then gives the decisions. Likewise, in life situations, those of us who are very critically developed, thoughtfully developed, there are problems, this, and you have to decide how to arrive at certain decisions, decision-making requires evaluation. So this will help, this will not help, this will help, this is relevant, this is not relevant, like that. So the highest power in the cognitive domain is critical thinking. Make your students thoughtful, critically awakened, so that they can use the facts for a higher level abstraction. So this evaluation is a higher level abstraction. And as I gave you three words to describe lower level learning, I will give you three words to describe these higher level learnings. Three words are learning of concepts, concept learning. Learning of inquiry, and third, learning of abstractions or problem solving. Learning of abstraction. Making more and more abstract decision making based on abstract facts. And you'll find concept learning is the goal and should be the goal of all types of teaching, including instruction. I talked about instruction yesterday. Even in instruction, we have to develop concepts. We have to help students to achieve concept learning. What is concept learning? Can any one of you tell me what is a concept? What is concept? What is a concept? No. Just idea is not a concept. What is the concept of a concept? Let us understand what is a concept. Anyone who can help me? Yes, yes, please.
Problem solving.
Problem solving, no. It's a higher thing. Problem solving is a higher thing. Concept is a lower thing. So what is concept? Ideas, that's a still lower thing. So what is that? What is the meaning of concept? Very difficult. Anyone who can come out? What is the real fact? What is color? Again, I'm asking you concept and you're saying color concept. Accepted by? And if they are not accepted? No. Now I will give a definition, and I'm sure you will not forget it. Concept is a class of objects, events, ideas, anything, facts, a class of ideas, objects, events, which generalize within the elements, those ideas or those objects, there will be generalization on the basis of common denomination, the common denominator. So there will be sharing of some common characteristics by the various elements, various objects, which will constitute a concept. So generalization within and discrimination between. When these two processes go together to describe something, that is called conceptualization. So you have one object. A child looks at one object or one animal, dog. Now next day he meets another dog, third dog, fourth dog. And as he grows, by the time you have grown, now you have seen so many dogs. Now, the idea of a dog is not concrete, but it is abstract in your mind. So, those dogs, they share certain attributes, certain characteristics. And then you generalize that these are all dogs. Generalize. And then you look at another object. Cat. The child says, this is a dog and this is a cat. Now, cat also has very many characteristics. Big cat, small cat, black, white. And then he generalizes, these are all cats. These are all dogs. These are all cats. Now, you want to test whether he has picked up, he has developed the concept of a dog and cat or not. So what you do is, you bring a cat which is looking like a dog and tell the child, 5-year-old child, which one is dog and which one is cat. He will be at last to see. But if he has developed concept, he will say, I will do like this. And barks, if it says meow, then he has developed a concept between a real concept of a dog and a cat. Otherwise, he will look at a cat genetically. If a cat has been produced which is just like a dog,
He will say, car, this is dog, this is cat. Make such conceptual errors. I, you, everybody makes conceptual errors because we don't understand the critical characteristics. Remember this word, critical. There should be sharing of characteristics. There should be discrimination between characters, distinction between one set of characteristics with another set. And then you should know what is the critical characteristic which differentiates this class from the other class. So in concept level teaching, what you do is you go on giving examples. This is, for instance, if you are teaching about a triangle, you will give large number of examples. This is a triangle, this small triangle, this is a big triangle. And then you will give large number of examples of a triangle. And then you will give examples of rectangles. This is a triangle, this is a rectangle. Now, what differentiates a triangle from a rectangle? If you develop that concept, then only your teaching will become pitched at concept level. You are promoting concept level. Otherwise, you are only developing memorization, comprehension, and at the most application. So to go at the higher level, you have to have concept learning. And when you relate one concept with another concept, third concept. For instance, you say H2O. H2O. What is H2O? What is H2O? That and O. So two twice H and one O. That will make what? If the person, now that is called rule learning. That is called higher than concept learning. He can relate one concept with the other to explain certain things. Now, if we say water finds its own level, what does it mean? When you are making the system, water finds its own level. If I drop water from here, it will go down, it will not go up. So these concept characteristics, they get related. When more than two concepts you are able, the student is able to relate, he has learned, rule learned, higher. And then still higher, when more than two rules he can put to use to get at a solution, that is problem solving. That is more abstract thing. So learning of more and more concepts, more and more principles, rules, and more of problem solving. That is, these three sets will belong to higher level. So, now, is it okay? You are clear now? In Bloom's taxonomy, lower level learning, knowledge, comprehension, higher level learning, analysis. So they are able to analyze this characteristic one with two, three, four, a number of characteristics, number of examples with non-examples. He is able to analyze that this is an example of X and this is an example of Y. Analysis. And then he is able to say within this they cohere, they correlate, and therefore you are able to synthesize. So similarities and differences, comparing and contrasting, you are able to do. And when you are able to help students to arrive at certain solution, given a problem situation, they are able to resolve it. They have developed that ability, that is the highest level. So these three types of learning. Now, as I told you at the very outset, there are two types of methods or strategies put in use. One I call direct and the other. Now, please take it now and register in your mind that lower level learning is taken care by direct method and higher level learning is taken care through indirect. Okay? Now I will proceed further. Now this basic point is Bloom developed the taxonomy not only for the cognitive domain, but his team developed the taxonomy for affective domain, the taxonomy for psychomotor domain. And I need not go to the various levels, but again, you start with, in affective domain, write down, there are five levels. Awareness. From awareness, valuing. Awareness, from awareness to interest, from interest to valuing, then characterization and value formation. These are the five. So highest level is values, development, promotion, inculcation of values. In psychomotor domain, again, in psychomotor domain, imitation. The lowest level is imitation. If you perform certain act, you have to imitate. There is somebody who demonstrates and you imitate. Then manipulation. Imitation, higher level, manipulation. And then after, again higher level, then manipulation, is precision. You manipulate things precisely. Suppose you are learning to operate a machine, then you will look at a person, how he handles it, then you will manipulate yourself, then you will precisely handle it. And there is precision followed by automaticity. We become automatic, natural. So there is naturalness in your skill. You perform things. For instance, every one of you has developed this psychomotor skill of writing. Everybody is writing, but the attention is on the idea that I am offering to you. If you are a beginner, then every attention will be there on your pen, how you are moving and how are you writing. Just as if you are going to learn a bicycle, learning a bicycle in psychomotor domain, how do you learn? I think everybody has learned how to ride a bicycle. Somebody puts you on the bicycle and gives a push like this. And after some time, you are on, the bicycle is on you. Instead of you being on the bicycle, the bicycle is on the situation. And then you learn to manipulate the bicycle, precise balance, and then you become very natural. Suppose you are coming from the guest house to this place by a bicycle, then you, those who have developed this skill at a very high level, without handling and using their hands, they will say, they will start from the bicycle, they will ride the bicycle, and they will come over here without. So that is the highest level, naturalness in the skill. Highest level in affective domain is value, that is characterization. And the highest level in cognitive domain is evaluation, critical thinking. So in order to develop these learning outcomes, you have to learn to use direct. have given you the background, and I will proceed with the various direct methods which have been used and which have been verified in terms of their effectiveness, how effective they can be in promoting learning, the desired learning outcomes, how direct methods can, and what will be the learning outcomes in using direct methods? Knowledge, comprehension, and application. What will be the learning outcomes in promoting high-level learnings? Analysis, power of analysis, synthesis. So your job is, now I will talk about these direct methods and indirect methods with the help of examples.
You'll find here examples of type 1 and examples of type 2 learning. I have talked to you about the two types of learning, type 1, that is lower level, and type 2, that is higher level. Now you can see in the table 7.1, you find three heads are there, three columns are there. One column is headed by the word facts. The other column is headed by rules. And the third column is headed by action sequences. And examples are here. Facts. Recognizes multiplication with two-digit numbers. How two-digit numbers can be multiplied. Now, next example. Identify apostrophes. Suppose it is a case of mathematics, then two-digit language. And likewise, you can draw good many examples of facts. Then, in language, apostrophe. You use apostrophe after a word. Doctor's son. Doctor's car. So you are putting this here as in the category of facts. And then select multiple words from a list. Select multi-syllable words. So there are multi-syllable words, and if you have given them a training in syllables, how to pronounce and how to memorize multi-syllable words. For instance, if I give you an example, multi-syllable words.
How this word will be pronounced is a multi-syllabic technology. Now I put another word. Many people will say, biola. Is it biola? How do you pronounce it?
Biology.
Yes, please.
Zoology.
Now, I'm giving you training in how to pronounce these words. These are multi-syllabic words. Many people, now I put another word. Yes, it is psychology. I have studied psychology and biology. Psychology. Yes.
How will you give training in pronunciation? Now say, Laji. You say, Laji. Laji. Kalaji. Kalaji. Psychology. Laji. Kalaji. Psychology. Now everybody will learn. Now say, every one of you say, Laji.
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 Knowledge.
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 Technology.
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 Technology. See, this is called a backward build-up technique in language. And we teach pronunciation. So if you have multiple syllables, all this you have to learn to cut. Materials, they will come from your textbooks. And you prepare a list of that learning item which will belong to the category of X, those which belong to the category of the second. What is the second category? In the example? Rules. One fact put with another fact. And to explain something. So, at the factual level. This rule is at the factual level, not at the abstract level. So, rule learning, that is comprehension. Rule learning will involve comprehension, understanding, seeing the relationship between one fact and the other fact, and a number of facts. If you are able to relate, that is rule learning. And then you are able to put action sequences. What will come if you are making a sentence? Which word, which category of words will come first? And which category of words will come in between? And which words will come at the end? He eats an apple daily. So noun or pronoun will, the sentence always starts with the noun and pronoun. The sequence is noun or pronoun, subject, then you have the object, and then you have in between the verbs. And you have finite verbs, you have helping verbs, and you have to put the sequence. The main verb will follow the auxiliary, helping verb, and it will not be followed by. He is living for Delhi today. You can't say he living is for Delhi today. You can't say that. Action sequences are there. So this is again, this will, all these three. You can look at the examples now. Now, go quickly. Rules. Carrying with two digits. I have taken examples, mathematics, and then you say finding words with apostrophes. So you will ask the students in this paragraph, identify those words which are using apostrophe. And then pronouncing multiple, just now, and then combining two parts, that is hydrogen and with one part. When these two facts you put together, that becomes what? This learning, and then learning of action sequences, multiplying to 1,000, using apostrophes in a sentence. Reading the stories with multi-level words and writing the apostrophe, the writing the expression for this will come in the third time. Now you go to the second category of learning. What will be the various elements of the second category?
Second category means lower level or high level. Now we can do examples of type 2 outcomes, learning outcomes, concepts, patterns, and abstractions. Now you have three headings, concepts like positive and negative numbers, and patterns like minus 3 into minus 4 into 11 is equal to 0. And you have abstractions, signs and numbers. Likewise, you can go with possessive form, concept, possessive form. And then you have police officer's daughter, Mrs. Burns people. And you have in the abstraction ownership. Then vowels and consonants. And you have the consonant vowel order. Consonant vowel consonant order. This is the pattern. In the word CVC, consonant vowel consonant like that. And then you have vowel consonant blends. How do you? So, school, recline, climb, CL. So you have the consonant clusters. The consonant clusters you have to develop as patterns. And then elements, atomic weight and valence. And here pattern. H2O and here molecular. Now you find table 3, instructional objectives requiring type 1 and type 2 outcomes. The examples are given here. The objectives, the objective is to recognize multiplication to 1,000. Then teach the multiplication tables and have the students find examples like this. Now you go at leisure, and these examples you will find it very helpful to you. Keep it in your file. Now I will give you another set to illustrate the examples of direct teaching. Now you read with me. Direct instruction or direct teaching has been referred to as active. Teacher is more active as compared to the other. Has been described as active teaching, which is characterized as follows. Active teaching, direct teaching is characterized as follows. Full class instruction as opposed to small groups. So you have 40 students, you are teaching them. That is direct teaching. I made this point earlier also. Organization of learning around questions you pose. You start with a question. And you start with a number of questions in a series. And you will stimulate them to think on the subject. Why is it that our weather is changing? The weather cycle is changing. You start with this question. If you are teaching environmental studies or environmental problems, then you start with this. Why our weather is changing? What was the temperature yesterday? What is the temperature now? What is the temperature in the evening? Now you start with questions. And then provision of detailed and redundant practice. Give more practice, more than required. If you give practice, then your students will be able to master the facts. And they will be able not only to master the fact, but also the relationship among facts. And then action sequence they will be able to. So, active teaching, that is presenting material to learners, so to learners to master one new fact, rule or sequence before the teacher presents the next. Don't bring too many facts together. Present one fact, then another, systematically. And this is the hallmark of a good direct teaching. Then formal arrangement of the classroom to maximize recitation. So they put their words and they memorize and they reproduce, like that. So you have now some direct instructional strategies. You will find six of them here. Daily review. The teacher goes to the class. He conducts daily review, checking previous day's work and reteaching if necessary after checking homework. If he finds that students have made some errors, they have committed errors, showing that they have not understood the facts or the action sequences. So what will you do? Checking homework and reteaching areas where there students
errors.
This is the first. Then second, I'm giving you this, these are all supported by research evidence. And this promotes more than 80% learning. If you do not follow this sequence, this will ensure 80% direct learning, lower level type of learning that I have mentioned. The second is presenting and structuring new content. Provide overview. I'm going to do this now, as I did begin with. I'm going to do this. So presenting an overview, then provide overview, proceed in small steps, if necessary, but at a rapid pace. This small step presentation is very, very essential, because many times students are not ready to receive you. So go step by step and make those steps small and easy to take. If these steps are not small and easy, they will be stuck up somewhere. So these are the very important principles. Then next, what is the next? If necessary, give detailed or redundant instructions and explanations, and then new skills are phased in while old skills are being changed. The old skills, whether they are on it or not, they are able to develop a grip over the old skills, and new skills are being phased in. Then next, guided student practice. It's very important. So you begin with guided student practice. High frequency of questions and overt student practice from teacher and materials. Then prompts are provided during initial learning when appropriate. What is prompt?
You see, when you present things, that is a stimulus. Now, that stimulus is not being taken properly or correctly by the student, so you give another stimulus. This support stimulus is called a prompt. So, all students have a chance to respond and receive feedback. Teacher checks for understanding by evaluating the student response and then continue practice until student responses are got. They are in their repertoire. They are established in their repertoire. And then success rate of 80% or higher during the initial. Ensure this. Then feedback and corrective and recycling of instruction if necessary. Feedback to students, particularly when they are correct but hesitant. They are giving an answer and they are hesitant. Give them, oh, yes, yes, right, okay, go ahead. Same like that. Feedback. Then, student errors provide feedback to the teacher that corrections and or reteaching is necessary. So teacher also gets the feedback. And then, next, corrections by simplifying questions, giving clues and explaining or reviewing step or reteaching last step. When necessary, reteach using smaller steps. So please make out from this, in direct teaching, you have to have a principle, governing principle for all direct teaching. That is called by the name of successive approximation. You write down? Successive approximation. What is successive approximation? This successive approximation means you demonstrate first. You demonstrate first what is to be learned. Just as I did. You have to learn to pronounce such multi-syllable technology, biology. I gave you the full demonstration. Then I took small steps. Lazy. Ecology, technology. I went with the small successive approximation. The entire world. Now, if I have to teach long sentences, then I will go in for connected sentences afterwards and simple sentences first. Now suppose I do this here, and if I have to build on this, then how shall I proceed? I will give you a sentence, and after having made the sentence, I will give you a stimulus word, you have to learn to add it. This is called add-on exercise. And I'm training you in the use of a particular sentence pattern. I have to. What is the pattern? I have to go. I have to go to the bank. All of you? I have to go to the bank. I have to go to the bank. I have to go to the bank to cash a check. Because I need some money. I have to go to the bank to cash a check. Because I need some money to purchase a shirt.
But this is
the bank. I have to go to the bank.
Cash a check.
Because I need some money.
For my friend.
Who
is coming from Bombay to me?
That is how I suggest you get the idea. That is how you. And if there is a student who is hesitant, give them feedback. Oh, yes, yes. I have to go to the bank. See? Cash a check. No. I have to go to the bank. Because I need some money.
Cash a check before I need some money.
I have to go to the library. Every one of you?
I have to go to the library.
To get a book. Suggested by the teacher. On the topic allotted to us. There are so many good many drills that you can take up through direct teaching. I have just given this one example, and then independent practice, so that student responses are firm and automatic. So you give them 10 sentences. I have to go to the guest house. Because I am feeling tired. After a good dose of lecture from a gentleman. Yes. Who has bothered us a lot. Okay? So you are doing this exercise. I have given you enough hints now to organize classroom instruction using direct teaching. And then last one, seat work. Go from seat to seat. Seat work, then unitization and automaticity. Practice to need for procedure to ensure the student is during seat work. That is, teacher or aid monitoring. And then 95% correct. And then weekly and monthly reviews. Reteaching. I have given you one. Now I will just give another model which was reported long back, but after that, we have now more than 24 models reported and which have come as an evidence accruing from research. The first model that was reported in 1962, that is called basic teaching model. And that has four components. And that model holds good in respect of all the subjects, whether it is science or mathematics or social science, social studies, or language. So, what are the components of that model? Develop lower level learning. That is learning of acts, learning of rules, and learning of actions. That is promoting knowledge, competencies, promoting comprehension competencies, and habits. If you have to use this one, this is a four component model. There are four components, A, B, C, and D. A is objectives. Right? Instructional objectives. So you formulate your objectives. As a teacher, if you are teaching for 35 minutes or 40 minutes, after 40 minutes, students will learn this fact. They will show this kind of comprehension. You mention the instructional object. In the first box, instructional object, the goal. What do you want your students to learn? You should be very clear. Then, in the second box, you have the entry behavior. Entry behavior of learners. Entry behavior of learners. The objective that you want to achieve, the learning outcomes that you want to develop, with reference to those learning outcomes, what is already there in their behavioral repertoire? That is called entry behavior. The behavior with which they enter the instructional situation, where you are conducting your instructional teaching. For instance, when your, this is workshop or seminar?
Yeah, short-term course.
Short-term. Now, if I interpret it with the help of basic teaching model, what is my objective? To familiarize you with direct and indirect teaching method. This is my opinion. Then I make a mental picture of your entry behavior. What are the things that you already know? What are the skills that you already possess? What is your mindset? Will you like to know these about these methods, or you will hate it? There are many people, oh, this is all mechanical routine, but it is not so mechanical as you think. So I have to take care of those people also who are coming with a negative mindset. Those who are entering here with a negative mindset, their chehra will be blushing or flushing. Unke chehre par muskan hogi ya gambhirta hogi. कहाँ फंस गए? बहुत से लोग जो गंभीर हैं, तो उनको देखकर मुझे भी लगता है कि मैं कहाँ फंस गया। यदि आप हंस नहीं रहे, मैं हंसने की बात कहूँ और आप सीरियस हो जाएं, और मैं सीरियस बात कहूँ और आप हंसे, इसका मतलब ये आदमी नॉर्मल कई बार ऐसा होता है क्लास में आप जिन बच्चों को समझ रहे हैं कि वो कोऑपरेट करें दे आर एक्चुअली नॉट नॉन कोऑपरेटिव लेकिन यू मिस टेक देम एक तो वर्ड है टेकिंग और दूसरा मिस इज अ वेरी डेंजरस वर्ड व्हेन यू मिस टेक समथिंग और व्हेन यू मिस अंडरस्टैंड समथिंग अंडरस्टैंडिंग इज मिस नॉट मिसेज Misunderstanding is a very dangerous creature. Once it is allowed to develop, it will prosper, it will flourish, and misunderstanding will create more misunderstanding. Yeh maalum hai ki woh main baar baar dekhta hoon, toh tum misunderstanding mein kyun hai? और मैं फिर और मिसअंडरस्टैंडिंग आप भी करेंगे क्या अब तो साधना में जाने ही नहीं देगा और फिर मिसअंडरस्टैंडिंग ये आदमी तो एकदम हमारे बगल में जा रहे तो मिस है आप व्रत नहीं मानते वो भी मानेंगे तो क्या कर लेंगे मैं आगे चलें So you have now two principles. One principle I have given to you. Two more principles I will give for direct teaching. For teaching of facts, for teaching of rules, and teaching of actions. One I have said successive approximation. Tell them that is instructional objectives you have to decide, then entry behavior, and then in the third box here you write procedure, instructional procedure. Procedure. So this is the hub of your activity. This is the hub, actual hub, where you are teaching, presenting, asking, structuring, and explaining all these things you are doing. That is C. That's the main, ye actual run of booming battlefield where you are face to face with your students. Daily you are face to face with your students. That is C. The first two are invisible acts. Entry behavior you assume, instructional objectives you formulate, but this you plan, and then by planning it, you act on it, you execute it, and develop it. That is C, and then you get to admission. To admission. You have A, B, C, and after evaluation, if you find that the instructional objective has not been accomplished, has not been realized by more than 80% students, then my dear friends, in this model and according to this model, the requirement of this model, you have to do reach. You have, I will not use the word failed. You have not failed at this teaching. But you have not reached the goal. And therefore, you do re-teaching. And how do you do? This is called feedback loop. You use this feedback, evaluation, you use it as a feedback, redesign the instructional procedure. And how do you redesign the instructional procedure? By revisiting the entry behavior, because you made some wrong assumptions about your students' knowledge, skill, background, etc. And then you have to reformulate your instructional logic. This model, if used properly, it will make you competent teachers. After evaluating the learning outcomes of your students. So, if you are teaching for 35 minutes, even if it is 30 minutes, after having taught, give a small test and see whether the test provides you with the evidence that the learning outcomes have been realized. If they have not been, next day when you begin, you reteach. That is what I have suggested. So, now you have gone whole hog to the direct teaching methods, procedures, the procedures that we use. Now, what are the various strategies that we use? There are five strategies we use. And before I go to those five strategies, strategy number one, right? Strategy number one, expository presentation, lecturing.
expository. Strategy number two, question answer session. We call it interactive sessions. Interactive sessions. Question answer sessions. Third, lecturing are presentations with examples. Whatever you say to your class as a point, you illustrate it. So, lecturing with examples. Yesterday I did it. Each point that I made, it was illustrated with an example. Lecturing with an example. Fourth, team teaching. Team teaching. Two or three of you from your institution, if you find that one of them is very good in this area, then you can make a team and you can make your presentation through team. And your direct teaching will become much more effective in terms of its effects. Team teaching. And lastly, team teaching requires a proper understanding about the strengths of the team. And unless you are able to properly assess the strengths of other members, because every one of us is not good in everything, so you can make a team. One is good in this, and the other is good in this, and the other is good in... So you make a team, and you will be able to deliver good results. And the last, demonstration. Demonstration method. There are several aspects. These are the five studies. Demonstration, demonstrating. Just as when I was explaining to you effectiveness, I demonstrated here with the help of an example. So demonstration works because demonstration goes to the world of work. It travels to the world of work very fast. If you have demonstrated something here and students have developed good comprehension, they will go in for effective application in life situations. And then I have completed direct method. I will give you the two principles. One principle I have already given. What is that? What is the principle I have given you? Successive? You tell them, this is what I am going to do. The golden principle is, tell them what you are going to, tell them. And after having told them, tell them what you have told them. Okay? Tell them, them means? Tell them what you are going to tell them. And after having told them, you tell them what you have told them. This is the principle. Number one. Number two principle. Successive approximation by telling them what you are going to do. This is the behavior you have to learn. This is the problem you have to learn. This is the application you have to learn. These are the action sequences you have to learn. These are the facts you have to learn. And two more principles. I will use acronyms. KISS principle. K-I-S-S. KISS principle. Always use this principle. In addition to successive approximation, use KISS principle. What is that principle?
KISS.
Keep I. K for keep, I for task. Keep I, it, keep it simple and specific. The task that you give in the process of comprehending, memorizing, remembering the action sequence, keep it simple and specific. That is key skill. And don't misunderstand. Many of them will say, well, his principle is also there. His principle here is keep the task, the learning task, simple and specific. And then the next principle is what is it? Miss. Kiss and miss.
Make it short and simple.
No. Make it soft and sweet. Think it is very wonderful. You are only thinking of simple and specific. Make it soft and sweet. Successive after the mission, by telling them what you are going to tell them, then kiss wisdom. Remember these, and you will be not only an effective teacher, but a wonderful effective teacher. Okay, you are. Tomorrow I will discuss in some detail about management of learning and then the indirect aspect. Okay. Any questions you like to ask?